it's my pleasure as presider this morning to introduce our speaker. The topic this morning is turning grief to purpose, working to reform our broken mental health system, which seems like an incredibly relevant topic, particularly this year. And we have Norman Ornstein with us. Norman Ornstein is a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. He's a contributing editor and writer for The Atlantic, and he's been an election eve analyst for CBS News and BBC News. He's chairman of the board of the Campaign Legal Center. His family foundation, the Matthew Harris Ornstein Memorial Foundation, sponsors a summer debate institute for public school kids in the Washington area through the Washington Urban Debate League, and created and funded the documentary, The Definition of Insanity, that was broadcast on PBS in April of this year. It tells the story of how a remarkable judge in Miami-Dade County, Florida, transforms the way its criminal justice system deals with those with serious mental illness, saving lives and saving money at the same time. He served as a senior counselor to the Continuity of Government Commission and co-directed the AEI Brookings Project on Alternatives to the Independent Counsel Act. Mr. Ornstein led a working group of scholars and practitioners that helped shape the law known as McCain-Feingold, which reformed the campaign financing system. He was elected as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2004. He has many books, which include Intensive Care, How Congress Shapes Health Policy, The Broken Branch, How Congress is Failing America and How to Get It Back on Track with Tom Mann, and the New York Times bestseller, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, How the American Constitutional System Collided with the New Politics of Extremism, also with Tom Mann. Excuse me, this book was named one of the 10 best books on politics in 2012 by The New Yorker and one of the best books of 2012 by The Washington Post. There's an expanded edition that's retitled It's Even Worse Than It Was, and that was published in 2016. His latest book with EJ Dionne and Tom Mann, One Nation After Trump, A Guide for the Perplexed, the Disillusioned, the Desperate, and the Not Yet Deported, published in 2017, was immediately on the New York Times and Washington Post bestseller lists. Ornstein has a BA from the University of Minnesota, a master's and a PhD from the University of Michigan. He received an honorary Doctor of Laws degree from his alma mater in 2007. He was also spotlighted as one of 2012's 100 top global thinkers by Foreign Policy magazine. And it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Ornstein this morning. We're very happy to have you here, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Sarah. I must confess that I'd rather not be with you, that I'm here basically because of a tragedy that occurred in our family that is the worst that can happen to a family. We lost our son, Matthew, almost 6 years ago on January 3rd, 2015. Accidentally, he died at age 34 after a 10-year struggle with serious mental illness. Matthew was a remarkable, talented, brilliant, compassionate young man, a national champion high school debater who went to Princeton and excelled, and then was out in Hollywood pursuing his passion and doing quite well when he had a psychotic break at age 24, the age at which these things tend to happen, and went through 10 years of hell, as we did as a family. A part of Matthew's brain disease was what's called anosognosia. It took me a while to learn even how to pronounce it, but it is in the brain where you have no insight into your illness. Matthew thought that God had come for him and had taken his soul and left his body, and he was on a journey to recapture his soul. He didn't know why, but he believed that if he took medicine, that would move him further from his path. And in our country, in most places, if you're over 18 and you refuse treatment, there's almost nothing that can be done. There's an irony in this, which is that if you are, let's say, over 70 and you develop dementia or Alzheimer's, the society treats it in a different way. It's seen as a brain disease. We have been in circumstances, my mother-in-law facing that some years ago, where doctors were perfectly happy to share medical information with my wife where there was deference given because there was an understanding that this was a brain that had gone awry, where mental illness more generally, and especially serious mental illness for people who are younger, is often considered something where if you just get your act together, it would be fine, where you are willfully acting in that fashion. And that's simply not the case. And it's particularly not the case for the 30, 40% or more who have no insight into their illnesses, those who have a serious illness like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, or schizoid affective disorder, the different things along the range of the continuum of what are brain diseases. And we don't, I should add, consider them to be diseases of an organ in the same way that we consider cancer or kidney failure or other things as diseases. I can't tell you how many times, for example, our friends and others we knew, people who are smart, highly educated, would say to us, why don't you just kick him in the ass and get him moving? Because of course, believing that his soul had been taken away left him depressed as well as in the midst of delusions. And that's just simply not how you deal with these. But we have a broken mental health system. And when Matthew died, after going through terrible things, you know, like so many who have a serious mental illness, he smoked. There's something about nicotine that soothes the brain for those with serious illnesses. There is a, he didn't cut his hair generally or shave, he had a beard. For people with a serious mental illness, there's a stigma that's attached to it. The society stigmatizes. If you smoke now, it's a second level of stigma. So he was shunned a lot, and it was very difficult for him as it was for the rest of us. When he died, we were, of course, just catatonic, stricken, and you have to decide what you're going to do in the midst of a tragedy of this sort. It's easy to just curl up and not move on. We decided, as the title of this presentation would suggest, to try to turn grief to purpose. And so we created a family foundation. We have some means of our own. We're not super wealthy. And I should add that, you know, I've been in Washington, as my wife has, for 5 decades, immersed in our political process. We are well connected. We've known presidents, leaders in Congress, judges, and others. We had all the means at our disposal to try and help our son, but a system that wouldn't allow us to. And for most of that time, we lived in Maryland, one of the most liberal states in the country, rated 50th out of 50 by the Treatment Advocacy Center for access to treatment for those with serious mental illness. And what we've learned is that the most liberal states bend over backwards to say that everybody is a person who can act however they want, and they are have free will, ignoring the fact that those without insight are then free to freeze to death on the streets as homeless people, or to end up in prisons or jails, which is the reality for a very large number of those with a serious mental illness. The single largest repositories of those with mental illness in the country are the Los Angeles County Jail, the Cook County Jail, and your own Rikers Island. And the treatment there is horrific for people with serious mental illness. We decided we wanted to do something after our son died that would help keep other families from having to go through the horrors that we had gone through, and to help others like our son from going through what he went through. Awful as it has been for us, awful as it was for us throughout those 10 years, it was nothing compared to what was going on, not just inside his own brain, but in the way he was treated through the rest of society as well. So, several months after Matthew died, I was approached by a number of members of Congress what became the 21st Century's Cures Act, the first significant federal piece of legislation to try and deal with serious mental illness, was foundering in Congress. Problems on both sides of the aisle, and those who knew what had happened to me, this, as Sarah's introduction would tell you, was not my in my wheelhouse before all of this. I dealt with politics and policy more generally, but asked if there was anything that I could do. And after consulting with my wife and our other son, Danny, I wrote a piece in the New York Times that opened up about our son and also about the broken nature of the system. And right around the same time as that piece came out, and I got an enormous amount of feedback, I should add, lots of people, and I would say a common theme in letters, in emails, in phone calls was, I've never told anybody this, but my father died of suicide. My sister died of suicide. I have a son who is in the midst of a psychotic break, and I don't know what to do. The stigma became very apparent. But right around the time that that piece came out, I went to a program in Washington where a judge named Steve Lifman was honored as the best, it's called the Rehnquist Award, named after the former Chief Justice, by the state and local judges in the country as the best state and local judge. And I went to a program and met his mother first, who happened to have roots in the city where I grew up in Minneapolis, and then connected with Judge Lifman. And we began to communicate back and forth. He had read my piece and we had actually seen him in a program earlier at a forum run by Patrick Kennedy in Boston. But before long, my wife and I went down to Miami and immersed ourselves in his program and were blown away as we realized that there were ways to improve this system. And while our son had never had significant encounters with the criminal justice system, it's the reality for the majority of those who have a serious mental illness. And what Judge Lifman had been able to do over 20 years was to transform this county, the seventh most populous in the country, with the largest concentration of people with serious mental illness, in part because people gravitate to a place with a climate where if you're homeless, you're not going to freeze to death, but also because so many with serious mental illnesses try and self-medicate. And the availability of drugs also made a difference. And a county which had struggled to cope, as so many others have, with these issues and these problems. And Judge Lifman spent 20 years after his initial encounter showing how broken the system was there, where he had to deal with a very minor offense for another young man, in this case, a graduate of Harvard Medical School and the chief resident in psychiatry at Jackson Memorial Hospital down there, who had his own psychotic break and was homeless. And he was not able to help. And what he did over a period of time was to find ways to create partnerships across areas where there are natural adversaries within the criminal justice system, starting with the judges, the prosecutors, the defense attorneys, and moving on to the jailers and the police and others. And really two major components to a program that have been built over 20 years with great success. One is in this huge county with almost 30 different entities, units, ranging from small to large, including the city of Miami, bringing police to train them in crisis intervention, an intensive week-long program developed in Tennessee after tragedies there and encounters between police and those with serious mental illness, to get police to be sensitive and to de-escalate conflict with those with a mental illness when they're on calls, rather than to escalate conflict. It's fairly apparent that you're trained as a police officer, you go to a situation where there might be conflict, you issue orders, to people who might be involved in a conflict. And if the orders are not obeyed, you escalate. If you're dealing with somebody with a serious mental illness, that's the worst possible way to treat it. And while police went kicking and screaming to this initially, over time, training more than 7,500 police officers, they've changed the culture of police, and they've gone from an average of one shooting or two shootings a month, I should say, in encounters between police and those with a serious mental illness in this county, to five or six over the last 8 to 10 years. And they've cut the number of arrests in half. If people are not shot under those circumstances, they're often tased or arrested for resisting arrest. One of those offenses that can take somebody who did nothing wrong, who was where police were called by a relative because it was a situation they could not deal with, or by a neighbor, and there's no real charge to make, but then there's a charge of resisting arrest. Cut the number of arrests in half, and they were able to close one of the three major jails in the county and save $12 million a year. That's now $84 million saved over the last 7 years. By cutting the number of shootings, they've also dramatically cut the number of wrongful death or wrongful assault suits. And the city of Miami was able to improve its bond rating because of all the money saved on that front as well. The second and core part component of the program is a jail diversion program. It started with misdemeanors. It's moved to many categories of nonviolent felonies. People who are brought in and judged to have a mental illness are fundamentally given a choice of going to trial. And most of them know that that's likely to result in jail, or going into a program where they're provided with wraparound services, a place to live, which is a critical part of this, social workers, medical professionals, people working in the program, and the secret sauce, as Judge Leifman says, the peer counselors. Every month they come back to the courtroom and they're evaluated and whether they're complying with the program. And it's obviously an individualized program. For some, it will require medication. For others, not necessarily. They're often trained, given job training. They're encouraged to improve their own education. And after a year, if they've complied with the program, they are off. The charges are expunged, which is huge. And many of them are able to go out and resume productive lives. It's a very different sort of thing than is done in most places in the country, even those that have mental health courts or those that have what's called assisted outpatient treatment. Don't have the comprehensive treatment. And if you have a program where you just provide somebody with medication, somebody comes by once a week to give them the meds, or a mental health court that doesn't give people the support to be able to function in the society, you're not going to end up with good outcomes. Now, there's a side benefit I would add to one part of this program, the crisis intervention training with police. They're now getting this quite remarkable woman who does that training, gets 150 calls a month from police officers who have their own mental health issues. Many are veterans who came back from Iraq or Afghanistan with PTSD. Others are in stressful situations on a regular basis in their jobs. We need to recognize that if you're a cop and you're making a traffic stop and you walk up to a car, you don't know if somebody might have a gun and shoot you. And if you're in that kind of stressful situation, whether you're in Afghanistan or on the streets of Miami, the natural reaction of a human being in a stressful situation is you get the adrenaline flowing because cortisol surges into the brain. And the more that happens, the more it can change your brain. And that is often what results in PTSD. Stressful situations, we know from research, if you're a police officer and you've been in a stressful situation, and that can mean going into a situation with domestic violence, not one where you're necessarily directly threatened, but where you see tragic things, the likelihood of your then being involved in something that could have violence at a later point in that day is increased as well. And if you can take people away from that, if you can treat police without them having to be seen as weak or even removed from their positions, which is one of the reasons why many don't even talk about it, and why more police officers die of suicide each year than in the line of duty. If you can treat that, you can also reduce the tragedies that we see occurring on our streets. So we saw this program and we decided that the best thing we could do, using our resources and with support from others, because we didn't have the ability to do it on our own, was to do a documentary about this remarkable program. That's the movie that Sarah referred to, The Definition of Insanity. You can all access it and watch it for free. We have a website. It's on the link to the invitation to this program, doifilm.com, which also has a lot of other information there. If you want to learn more about what we're doing and what we've done and what we intend to do, you can also go to our foundation website, which is mornstein.org. And it wasn't just to make a movie, just to show what Judge Lifman and his great team had done. We believe that the power of film is such that you can then use it as a catalyst. It's much more powerful than just talking about it or writing about it. And our intention has been to take it around the country and use it as a catalyst to get other communities to see what best practices there are and find ways to adopt them. And one way of doing that is to show how, even if different places don't have the same resources or even the same needs, there are ways in which you can make a difference here. And the challenge is you can save money and save lives at the same time, but you also have to make an initial commitment of resources to be able to do that. Commitment, for example, to do the crisis intervention training. I should note that Judge Lifman is actually on listening to our program today. And turn to him to ask or to answer a question or two as we go along. So our plans to take this around the country, we premiered the film actually at the Miami Film Festival in March of this year. It was successful enough that they did a second screening. It was March 9th and then on March 10th. And just as we finished the second screening, they shut the whole festival down. And that was the end of our travel. Our plans to take it physically around the country have been put on hold. But we've done a whole series of other programs thanks to the magic of Zoom and these other platforms. Most recently, just this past week in Illinois with the Chief Justice of the Illinois Supreme Court and a large group of people who are involved in their own task force in the state to try and reform the system with a panel that included three mothers who have had tragedies with their sons, including my own wife, Judy Harris, but also a quite remarkable woman from Chicago whose son just recently, after a long struggle with mental illness, where everybody, including the police, knew that he had a serious mental illness, was shot and killed by police unnecessarily, even as the police were saying, yeah, he's got a mental illness, and then they shot him. And that actually is a catalyst that we now have as well for rethinking the whole system. The George Floyd murder, followed by all the other tragedies, there seem to be at least one a week that occur. We're doing a program next week in Rochester where Daniel Prue, you undoubtedly saw in the weeks leading up to the election, the video, of him in the middle of a mental health crisis, being tackled by police with a hood put over him, and he suffocated, was asphyxiated, followed by days of demonstrations in Rochester. And as you saw, or as we discussed a little bit in the introduction, the defund the police movement that began with George Floyd, a term that is probably not the best one to use, but that has moved there. Reforming the criminal justice system takes us right into the ability as well to reform the mental health system. The two are inextricably linked together, and they provide opportunities for us now at the local level, at the state level, at the federal level, to begin to do something about this. That's not enough. We also need to deal with the mental health issues at the civil level. We need to move back to a point where we can provide beds for people. You know, one of the things that we see, if you look at why so many people with mental illness end up in jail, when police officers who have compassion pick up somebody in the middle of a mental health crisis, they often have no alternative but to go to a jail as a place where somebody can at least be away from the dangers that are there on the streets. There are no other places to go. We have a crazy system where the Medicaid money, which is necessary for our system, can't be applied to community health centers with more than 16 beds if they're dealing with mental health crises. We have little willingness to provide the kinds of resources. We have a broken psychiatric profession where most don't go into this and move on to get the specialty in psychiatry. Don't have any incentive, financial or otherwise, to treat those with a serious mental illness. My wife has often said that as we went through struggles with psychiatrists, that for psychiatrists dealing with this issue, think about a fire department where if you say, my cat's up a tree, they say, we'll be right there. But if you call and say, the house is on fire, they'll say, well, we have an opening next Thursday. Can you bring it by then? And that's not a way in which you can treat a crisis of this sort. So we have comprehensive problems that require comprehensive solutions. But what Judge Leifman's program has shown is that we can move in that direction across the political spectrum with support and save lives and save money at the same time. And we hope that we can use what we have been able to accomplish moving to the future to develop a different dialogue around the country, to take those who, I've talked to some in Minneapolis, for example, where I come from, where George Floyd was murdered, where the city council immediately passed a unanimous resolution to defund the police and then ended up with a situation that's very much like the proverbial dog chasing the bus and catching it, where they said, all right, we said we'll defund the police, what do we do now? What's required, among other things, is not only to train police officers, and it should go beyond police officers, to all first responders and to those in schools who deal with kids in the middle of mental health crises and often call in a security officer who throws a kid against the wall, who's acting out. This has to be done more broadly. But what we also know is that we need to give the police help in these situations. They shouldn't be the first ones called when there's a mental health crisis. They should at least be accompanied by mental health professionals. We know that if you do as Judge Leifman has done in Miami and train the 911 responders to send the right people when there is a mental health crisis, you can sharply reduce the level of conflict and the tragedies that occur. So we're on a journey here, and the more we can get people like those engaged in ethical culture to join with us to help reform the system, the better. And that's a good place for me to stop, I think, and to open it up for the group as a whole.
Thank you very much for sharing your story and your remarks and for sharing the documentary as well. I actually tried to find it on PBS first and immediately realized I couldn't watch it for free. And so I was a bit thwarted at that moment, but I appreciated seeing that there's a website where we can stream it for free, which we shared in the chat as well. So anyone that hasn't seen it yet, it's available for anyone to watch. And we'll open it up for questions. I have everyone in gallery view so I can see you. If you have a question, if you want to give a wave, we can unmute you, or you can raise your hand using the raise hands feature in Zoom as well. And it looks like Carol has a question. So Carol, if you just unmute and we'll start with you.
Thank you. I was wondering whether or not there's been experience with using a different kind of way of controlling the psychiatric patient other than tasing or convincing. In the movie, there was a very good mental health worker who used convincing very effectively. But tasing is dangerous in people who are in a mental health crisis. And I was wondering, what about a tranquilizer dart type therapy as used in veterinary medicine to control lions and tigers and whatever?
That's an interesting point. I'm afraid it's out of my wheelhouse. Steve, you have any reactions to that? What I would say, just as waiting to see if there is any reaction, if you train people to de-escalate in a very large share of cases where people are in crisis, you can move away from the crisis. It doesn't work all the time, and you're right. And of course, what we've seen in many cases is that they tase multiple times, and that can be deadly force itself.
Exactly.
Just as often, it's using guns.
Hi, Norm. Can you hear me now?
Necessary tragedies. Yeah, Steve, go ahead. This is Judge Lifeman, everybody.
Pleasure, and I apologize. I wasn't expecting to be on, so I haven't exactly shaven this morning. I've not heard about using some type of tranquilizer. It's an interesting concept and something I'm going to look into, but we do strongly encourage the de-escalation skill to be used first. And even out of, 105,000 cases, I think tasing has only been used in, I want to say, 15 or 20 cases. So they have done a really good job changing the way that they approach these cases. And there's been no shootings and there's been no deaths out of 105,000.
You know, it's so interesting to see how well this has worked in Miami. And one part of it that I really want to stress, there are places where they've trained police in crisis intervention, but the culture of the department hasn't changed. And we see some instances of tragedies where people have been trained, but they still end up shooting people in mental health crises. In Miami, they've changed the culture. So now what Judge Lifeman will tell you is that the cop who uses force in a case where it's unnecessary is seen as the weak one, not the one who finds a way to avoid using force. And that's a part of what has to happen. We have to change the culture in a lot of police departments. Unfortunately, police unions in New York is a poster child for this, are real obstacles here. The refusal to weed out bad cops or to create a culture where you are seen as bad if you misuse your position is something that we have to deal with.
This is so much of what you're saying, Mr. Ornstein, echoes a speaker we had a few weeks ago who was talking about police reform. And so we actually, I don't think it was intentional that we had both of you paired within a month, but we'll claim credit for that and be like, this was all a masterful plan to be on a quite similar and important message. There are a couple more people with questions. I wanted to see if Eleanor Kaplan, if you want to unmute.
Okay. Thank you so much for this. And as I said before we started, for the film, which I urge everyone to see, are there any organizations in New York that you find responsive to what has been shown and in fact proven in the Miami experiment and in the program that's going on there to replicate it here? That some of us could possibly support or look into?
So a few that I would mention specifically in New York, there's something called the Greenberger Center. which deals with criminal justice and mental illness. It's Greenberger, B-E-R-G-E-R. There is, I mentioned another area that we have been very much involved in here. There's a psychologist named Javier Amador, A-M-A-D-O-R, who has a nonprofit called the LEAP Institute. And Javier was very important for us. He had a brother with schizophrenia and anosognosia, and he struggled for years to try and help his brother, Henry, and wrote a book called I'm Not Sick, I Don't Need Help, where he had found a very good way to communicate with people in stressful situations, but especially those with no insight into their illnesses. It's called LEAP, which in, you know, for shorthand is listen, empathize, agree, and partner. And he's taught these techniques to a large number of people, family members, first responders, medical professionals, and others. We've partnered with him to do trainings around the country and now to train other people to train those. And that includes, as I mentioned earlier, in schools and elsewhere. If you can figure out how to communicate with people who otherwise are in stress, it can make a real difference. And you know, the Treatment Advocacy Center is not in New York. It's based in the Washington suburbs, but it's a terrific organization that we have worked with as well. And then there's NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness. Mm-hmm. For anybody who has a family member who's suffering and you don't know what to do, we always recommend that people go to their NAMI chapter. Yes.
There was a question in the chat that I'll raise from Esther. Have you encountered much pushback from police or the political community around this topic?
So I would say police, you know, what Judge Lifman found in Miami is there's a lot of resistance from police. First of all, they think we've been trained, we don't need any more training. Second, you have to take people off the beat for a week to do this. And it's a very intensive week. What he's been able to do and what he's learned is that as people went through the program, they realized it would help them and they spread it to others. But it's tough to move beyond the police culture as it exists. But not impossible. And, you know, we're not talking about a small department in Miami-Dade. So, but, you know, right now we're at a point where the police are adversaries with those in the larger community who want to see reform. That's where we're getting a big debate now about the term defund the police. And a lot of people saying, hey, you know, it doesn't matter what the slogan is. It's not about taking all their money away, it's about redirecting the resources. But if you use a term like that, and if police believe that they're all being targeted for the actions of the ones who've done bad things, there's going to be a visceral response. I also see this as being exploited badly by some of the unions, and we have obstacles to overcome there. We've got to change the way we talk about this. And one of the beauties with the Miami model is that they found ways to partner. In the political community, there's a divide. There are those who believe that there's no such thing as mental illness, or that, and understandably, if you go back through the history of this country and the history of how other societies have dealt with those with serious mental illness, they've treated them as if they weren't people. And we had horrible facilities here before we deinstitutionalized in the 1960s. We had people who sometimes were put away just because a family member didn't like them or because they wanted to get their money. And there was no due diligence or effort to have a due process. So you want to be cognizant of civil liberties. But, you know, my wife said tragically about our son, he died with his civil liberties intact. And when I, you know, if you go through what we went through, I used to pass people on the streets who were muttering to themselves, homeless people. You see them in New York all the time. We see them in Washington. And I would ignore them. or I would, you know, try and stay away. Now we pass people like that, and I think that could have been our son. It's not freedom if you take people whose brain deteriorates because they are not able to get treatment and they don't know that they're ill, and leave them in those situations. And so we have to strike a better balance there. And that's a problem that we see on the left. And the problem on the right has been the unwillingness to fund, even initially, some of these things. You know, when we were moving in the aftermath of President Kennedy's reforms to try and move away from institutions, the whole idea was that we would move them out of these asylums, most of which were terrible, into community health centers. And that ended up being thwarted because President Reagan cut the funding and put it out to the states, and they were unwilling to fund. My wife has something to add here.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Good morning. I just wanted to add two things to the New York organization's Brain and Behavioral Research Foundation. It's a wonderful organization, and they do great work on a completely nonpartisan basis. The other thing is, Judge Steve, maybe you can address the question of anybody, if anybody in New York is specifically looking at your program. We don't know whether you're working with anybody in New York.
So we have had some conversations, and I've been involved with the First Lady of New York, was very interested. She came down and looked at our program several times, and I've been up there to meet with her. And we've been working with the New York Police Department. There's a wonderful, I think she's a captain, who is kind of in charge of trying to make this happen in New York. And so I know that they're slowly moving in that direction. But I will say, I mean, I think from when we started to today, there is nationally a sea change in terms of the attitude. When we first started, you know, only Memphis was really doing it back then. But I think it's becoming a much more accepted practice to do a crisis intervention team program. There's an organization called CIT International. You can go online and check it out, and you can see if there's any New York departments that are specifically involved. But it is changing drastically. And I think, you know, everyone's starting to move towards a co-responder type model. Because one of the parts that bothers all of us, including the police, is when they have to transport someone, even if they have not committed a crime, to a psychiatric facility, they have to handcuff them and put them in the back of the police car. And that causes all kinds of terrible stigma. It makes it really hard to get the person to agree to treatment next time. And so this co-responder model would have professional mental health providers do the assessment and make the call and have the police's backup just in case there's any kind of violence, which rarely happens. I mean, we just have to start thinking about these issues as illnesses. We wouldn't put someone with cancer or dementia in the backseat of a police car in handcuffs to go get them treated. Why would we do it for somebody with a mental illness? And it's made it much worse. And I think it's a mindset, and that mindset fortunately is starting to change.
Thank you, Judge Leifman. We are running out of time. We'll do one more question. Ken, do you want to unmute yourself?
The question I have is, there's a gentleman that's on the corner of my building on 85th Street and Broadway, and he's been there for 3 or 4 years, and he sleeps on the sidewalk. And I think he has paranoid schizophrenia, but people try and help him, and he's very reticent. And, you know, I ask him if he wants coffee occasionally, he says yes, or he accepts blankets from people, but he's sleeping out in the street for 3 years. And I think that's ridiculous. You know, I don't know why, you know, something, this man is wasting away on the streets, and it's utterly, it's horrible. I, you know, I know they closed the mental institutions, but is he better off on the streets or being take care of in a mental institution that treats something like paranoid schizophrenia or whatever he has? I don't know. I'm not a medical doctor, but it sounds like it's that. And I don't know why, you know, it's very frustrating to see this man in there year after year, and I don't know what to do about it. Yeah.
One of the programs that we work with, it's called Lazarus Project. And
so what, Steve,
yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay,
ahead.
Sorry. One of the programs that we've teamed up with in Miami, it's called Lazarus Project. And we actually send a psychiatrist out on the street to meet with individuals exactly like you've described. He probably does have paranoid schizophrenia, but the choice doesn't have to be on the street or in a long-term institution. You have to begin an engagement process, gain some trust. And then what we do is we start to medicate the individual and get them to a point where we can get them off the street into housing. And what happens is for a lot of people with these illnesses, their brains are terribly overstimulated and they don't want to be near a lot of people, particularly in a housing type program that's in a dormitory setting. It's too loud and overstimulating, and that's why they prefer the street. And so what we try to do is get them healthier in recovery while they're on the street and then gently move them into the back into housing.
That's a good idea. Steve, I hope somebody does this person out there for 3 years, 4 years, or 5 years.
Terrible.
I don't know. I constantly see him. So yeah, anyway, that's a great idea. I hope they institute it in New York. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Ken. Well, thank you so much, Mr. Ornstein, for being here and for your remarks, and Judge Leifman. We didn't know you were joining, but it's such a great, you've been such a great additional voice to have in this. And obviously you're featured in the documentary as well. So one more plug for that. If you haven't watched it, please take a look. It's fascinating and really well done.